I'm Ron Gidwitz, the U.S. Ambassador to the Kingdom of Belgium. I want to congratulate all of you. Sorry I can't be with you today to celebrate the 106th Infantry Division. You folks did a great job over here 70 some odd years ago, and we are just so proud and so thankful to the veterans of the Golden Lions who sacrificed so much for our freedom and prosperity, particularly those folks that couldn't get home. We pause to remember them in particular. They are, as well as you folks, clearly responsible for the prosperity and freedom that Europe and we at home enjoy today. And for the family and friends of the 106th, we remember the sacrifice that so many made here in Europe 75 years ago. So thank you, congratulations, and God bless you.
December 1944, after the initial success of the D-Day invasion on June 6th, Allied supply lines were becoming too long to keep up with the advancing troops. A functional port was badly needed as close as possible to the German border to enable a further advance into Germany. At Antwerp, Belgium, the largest deep water port in Europe was miraculously captured intact in early September. Heavy fighting for the Scheldt estuary cleared the way for the first supply ship on November 28, 1944. It was the first of many. Antwerp could handle up to 1,000 ships at one time and offload approximately 40,000 tons of supplies per day. This proved a vital solution for the Allied supply problems, but it also became a thorn in the German side. In secrecy, Hitler and the German High Command drafted plans to recapture the port and split the Allied forces. Meanwhile, American troops were spread thin along a huge front line along the borders of Belgium and Luxembourg in the dark, eerie forests of the Ardennes. In this ghost front, there was little action, so it became an ideal place for unseasoned troops to become acquainted with the war in Europe and sit out the winter before the inevitable advance into Germany in the coming spring of 1945. However, it was there where the men of the 106th Infantry Division would receive their baptism of fire as the Germans launched their last-ditch bid to recapture Antwerp. Let us honor them together.
I don't know, it's been a long, long time ago, but it was damn cold, I know that. Well, we're the last division activated in the United States. We're right on the front line.
We landed in Le Havre on, I think it was December 7th. Drove up through Reims, through Philippeville, on up into the Ardennes.
And they moved us up to Belgium, up to the St. Vith area.
We're in Groß Langenfeld. which is just over the border between Germany and Belgium.
Our sergeant told us what the situation was, and we thought we were the luckiest guys in the world.
But it wasn't too bad until the Bulge, because we were on patrols and stuff like that.
My buddy and I, we set up living quarters in the master bedroom. He was an expert scrounger, and he had a footlocker full of food. So we set it up there, and boy, we were going to live out the war in comfort.
And little did we know what was going to happen.
Welcome, veterans of the 106th, family members, and ladies and gentlemen, to the special memorial service. My name is Randall Wood, and I'm the adjutant of the 106th Infantry Division Association. Under normal conditions, at this moment, veterans and families of our association would have been together at Kansas City, Missouri, for our annual reunion. Due to the pandemic, the board of directors decided to postpone this year's reunion till September 2021. Nevertheless, the board agreed that the memorial service should proceed. Through the miracle of technology and with enthusiastic input from all corners of the globe, we began to develop this virtual memorial service. Besides the traditional segments of our service, several veterans of our division participated and shared their personal experience. I guarantee you will be moved by what you see and what you hear. Without further ado, I would like to introduce our current 106th Infantry Division Association President and veteran of Battery A, 590th Field Artillery Battalion, Mr. Bob Pope, as he presents his thoughts about the Golden Lion Division and the world that we now face.
This is the President's message. I would like to share with you a few of my thoughts on this memorial occasion. It pains me when I read stories about the U.S. wars, and they include World War I, the Korean War, Vietnam War, and the Middle East War, and completely omit World War II. It pains me to hear teachers saying in the classroom that we started both World War I and World War II. Fortunately, there are some positives in the future. Some bright lights include Benjamin Mack Jackson and his World War II Veterans History Project. Ben has an extensive collection of personal interviews which he has made by listening to veterans tell in their own words their story of the Battle of the Bulge. These interviews, combined with his traveling museum and his speeches, have reached many thousands of people of all ages. Lesser lights include history buffs like 17-year-old Michael from New Jersey and a young man from Erie, Pennsylvania, both of whom called me out of the blue to seek information about the Battle of the Bulge to enhance their history of the war. Thank goodness for the History Channel on TV, which has many programs which cover the war from different angles and give a complete picture of the travesty of wars, especially World War II. Also, we need more people today, like news analysts in the past, Cedric Foster, who on January 21st, 1945, praised the American soldiers, and especially the 106th Infantry Division, for their heroic stance in the Battle of the Bulge. The significance of stopping Hitler when and where we did should not be overlooked in history, because it was the beginning of the end of war in Europe. The price of the Battle of the Bulge was enormous. It included thousands of Americans killed, thousands more wounded, and thousands more still captured by the Germans and taken to prison of war camps. Today, there are occasions when a tribute is paid to those who died and to those who survived. The Veterans Administration in Buffalo, it held a ceremony honoring those soldiers from Western New York who were either prisoners of war or missing in action. Also in the past year, www.slowroll invited me to talk live on Memorial Day evening about the meaning of Memorial Day and my role in World War II. I have received letters, again out of the blue, from two Belgian residents asking me to autograph a picture of me, but more importantly, both thank me, symbolic for the U.S., for coming over and helping to restore their freedom. Those of you who have traveled to Belgium have seen, heard, and felt the appreciation and love the Belgian people have for our soldiers. It's a shame that our reunion and millions of other events have been marred or canceled by the worst enemy the world has ever known, the coronavirus. It has invaded and expanded into all corners of our lives, and indeed the entire world. It has been devastating, especially to our veterans and other older citizens who are more vulnerable. Most activities and events have been disrupted, and it has caused death to many thousands of people all over the world. Today, we honor those members of our association who have preceded us and have died in the past year. Thank you, and God bless you.
Thank you, Bob, for that powerful message of remembrance. We now take you to the American Military Cemetery and Memorial in Ham, Luxembourg, for the presentation of colors by the honor guards of the U.S. Air Base and the Luxembourg Army. The footage you'll see was recorded during the 70th anniversary of the Battle of the Bulge in 2014. Several of our association members were present for the ceremony as they were honored by the Grand Duke Henri of Luxembourg and other heads of state.
Of the 5,073 American war dead interred there, 49 are GIs who served with or under the command of the 106th Division. Facing them is the grave of famous General George S. Patton, Jr.
Post the colors.
Yeah, it started in the morning about 5:27 a.m. and we got shelled to about noon.
Screaming, me needs 88. I was sure that next one was going to come right through the wall and blow up in our bedroom.
Yeah, once the attack started, yeah, immediately it just both German and GIs were in our aid station.
Well, some of them shells that were quite a short fuse, when they hit the treetops, it was just like a bunch of lumber, you know, just scattered all over. Just splinters, you know, just flying.
And then our sergeant came running into the log cabin, and he said, "The Germans are coming, the Germans are coming."
I was assigned to this machine gun bunker, so I tried to put my trousers on. I could not for the life of me get my feet into the trousers. So I threw them aside, grabbed my rifle, overcoat, helmet. So when the Germans attacked, I was fighting there in my underpants.
We followed the fellow on through the German lines. We went on up into Winterfeld. And when it came dark, then they all hell broke loose.
And my squad leader, he's a real big husky guy, and I was like a midget compared to him. He was killed instantly. We were sitting side by side. I don't know if he was a bigger target or what. It could have been me, you know.
Rumor A and B Company is wiped out. Thomas was killed, and rumors that service company is captured. Our patient was one of my best friends. The first one to die in the company.
Well, the Germans attacked twice that day, once in the morning, again in the afternoon, drove back both times.
In the very beginning, I just fired my rifles as quickly as I could without aiming, just bang, 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 until I finally slowed down and picked out my target and were able to stop the Germans that took.
That was really a bad day.
On that first day of the Battle of the Bulge, the German army unleashed its full fury on the men of the 106th. Isolated on the Schnee Eifel, two regiments of the division were bypassed on both sides by German infantry and armor. These columns wreaked havoc in their rear area. That morning, a column of German tanks broke through the lines of the 14th Cavalry Group and captured the village of Au in the rear of the 422nd Regiment, holding the north flank of the division. In heroic action, Sergeant Richard A. Thomas of the 422nd saved a group of engineers from the village, an action which later led him to being awarded the Distinguished Service Cross. With the capture of Au, the German panzers now rolled unopposed into the 106th Division's artillery positions. Our late dear friend and former association historian John Schaffner recalls how these German tanks attacked his 589th Field Artillery Battalion that morning in the village of Hersbach. Of their 12-gun battalion, only one howitzer was in a position to engage the enemy tanks.
And it was a crest, a little crest on the hill. Never saw them. I could hear all the commotion going on. And John's battery had a line of sight to them, these three tanks that were coming up the road. He knocked the first one out with his gun. And then the others retreated back. And so we got a march order, and myself and the other guy, we picked our bazooka up. Thank goodness we didn't have to shoot it at anything. Mm-hmm. And got in a truck, and we retreated back down across Engineer Cutoff, down to the road to Schoenberg, and went in position down there. The one battery couldn't get out. C battery out the battalion was stuck in the woods, and most of those guys were taken prisoner. But A and B battery managed to get away from that first position, and we went into position along the Leon Creek. The Germans attacked again down through the woods, and only one battery got out, A battery got out. I was in B battery at the time, and we had to leave our four howitzers there.
One of the officers of the 589th was Lieutenant Eric Fisher Wood, Jr., a graduate of the prestigious Valley Forge Military Academy and Princeton University. Corporal John Gatens of Battery A explains what happened on the morning of 17 December 1944 between Schoenberg and Bayoff.
Eric come running around hollering, "March order, march order." That means get up and get out. He said, "Get out of here as fast as you can. I'll meet you on the other side of Schoenberg. Now, what happened? We had four howitzers. Three of us got out. The fourth one got stuck in the mud, snow, whatever have you. And Eric stayed behind to help that crew get on the road and out. Now, the three of us got through Schoenberg with no problem. Unfortunately, Eric and the other howitzer, when they got to Schoenberg, there was a tank by a bridge, and it opened fire on the truck. It killed the driver and the sergeant of the crew. Eric jumped out of the truck on one side. The cannoneers went over into a ditch. Eric ran up into the wood.
The day after he disappeared into the woods, Lieutenant Wood and another stray soldier encountered a local resident of the village of Mayroad. He took both Americans into his home, where Eric explained his intent to infiltrate back to St. Vith or, quote, start his own private war against the Germans. After a night's rest, the men and the Belgian family parted ways. He was not seen again. During the month that followed, guerrilla actions were reported in the woods. On 25 February 1945, Lieutenant Wood's body was finally found. Nearby lay the remains of seven German soldiers. In gratitude for his resistance, a stone cross was placed at the spot where he fell. The monument in the woods is a testimony to his dedication to duty, service, and ultimate sacrifice to his country. Lieutenant Wood rests at the André Chapelle Military Cemetery in Belgium. Among many other accolades, he was awarded the Distinguished Service Cross for his bravery. At present, actions are taken in his home state of Pennsylvania to award the Medal of Honor. Thanks to the efforts of Lieutenant Wood, part of Battery A of the 589th Field Artillery was able to get back to St. Vith and escape the encirclement in the Snae Eiffel. Under the command of Major Arthur C. Parker, these remnants were quickly moved to the area of Barrac de Fraiteur.
With three howitzers out of original 12, they proceeded to reinforce this vital crossroads, which later became known as Parker's Crossroads.
And we had a little over 100 men out of the battalion, which normally is about 500 men. We were split up somewhere, and one group came here, and the other group went the other way. And during those days, there were other men from other units came here to help. Captain Brown answered the phone and said, we have about a dozen Germans in the middle of the road here looking at their mine chain. He says, okay, you fellas keep your head down and we'll sweep the road. And we just hunkered down in the hole, and they fired the 450 caliber machine guns on the half truck. And he said, when we stop firing, come back to the manhole. As soon as they stopped firing, we jumped out of the hole and ran up to the command post. And halfway out, my helmet bounced off my head. And I never lost a stride. I just kept going.
On the 23rd of December, elements of the 2nd SS Panzer Division assembled for their final assault on Parker's Crossroads. After a valiant five-day stand against all odds, the crossroads finally fell. John Schaffner explains how he was able to escape the SS troops carrying a wounded comrade to safety.
Men from the 325th Glider Regiment in the woods down below, and a couple of those guys were coming toward us, so they helped me get the other man out of danger. Mm-hmm. Carrying him down through the woods, they had a jeep there, and they took him off in a jeep. That was the last time I saw him until 1986.
General James Gavin of the 82nd Airborne called the five-day stand at Parker's Crossroads one of the greatest actions of the war.
In the city of St. Vith, our division memorial stands as a testimony to the sacrifice of the Golden Lions. In the cold winter of 2014, two Golden Lion veterans were invited to attend a World War II battle reenactment on the Permerberg, a commanding ridge east of St. Vith, where engineers of the 81st and the 168th Battalions defended the town from the German advance. To the battle reenactors, their recollections of World War II veterans are key to help their historical depiction and living history. Here we bring you the saga of the engineers and the Promerberg battle.
There was no, I don't think there was any snow on the ground at that time. That maybe started the next day or the day after. I think, I do remember snow as I recall. Maybe leaving the trains remind me of that.
Yeah. That you had the trench coats, the long trench coats?
You're darn right. Yeah, that's what we had, and that's...
And you were wearing
that. It really got cold when you worked out in January at below Berlin, out in the fields. Because, you know, you got closer to Russia, and you could feel that. Those Russian fronts come through, and those coats felt good. Between us and the cavalry was an open 2-mile area. Nobody, it was just not anybody. That's where the patrol went out every 4 hours.
Okay.
And, but you were down for 23rd, down
below. Yeah, I was
in
a different regiment, different place.
And you got captured 19th.
Same weather, though. Same weather.
Colonel Riggs after the war of the 81st Engineers, and he was captured up in front of St. Vith, but he put up a big fight with the what engineers he had.
I am Thomas J. Riggs, Jr. I was the division engineer of the 106th Infantry Division. The division commander asked me to set up ordered me, as a matter of fact, to set up a defense line astride the Schoenberg-Sanvith Road to hold that road for the promised counterattack of the 7th Armored and as an escape route for our two infantry regiments to the front.
We weren't there very long before they attacked. The shells were coming over left and right, and they were hit in the on top of the trees, and the shrapnel would come straight down, and even some of the men on the Vonso were getting hit, because we trained together. So they all knew my name, so when they got hit, it was, "Dick, I'm hit."
By about midnight, we'd lost communication on both flanks with the two units, so we knew we were being completely isolated. We could then, in the dawn's light, see that all of the roads leading into Sanvith were full of German troops concentrating on and going through Sanvith.
I walked around to see who was hit, and I came across my buddies. He's sitting on his foxhole. So when I touched him, and he fell right over. He was dead. After a while, they came around and told us that, you're surrounded, head down towards the road.
We obviously could not counterattack. I attempted at that time to split them up into patrols so they could attempt to work their way back to the friendly lines, the U.S. lines. We started two of these patrols out and watched both of them captured. And shortly thereafter, I was captured with the remainder of the group.
The engineer defense of the Primerberg withstood several heavy attacks during the period of 16 to 23 December 1944. Left as a rear guard, they defended St. Vith and enabled friendly forces to fall back to the Somme River. The valiant defenders of the 81st and 168th Combat Engineer Battalions, along with other units of the 106th and the 7th Armored Division, were later awarded the Presidential Unit Citation. After Christmas 1944, the city of St. Vith and its vital rail and road infrastructure was completely destroyed by the Allied Air Force. The ruins of the town were finally liberated by the 7th Armored Division on the 23rd of January 1945. Countless civilians and soldiers had lost their lives in severe fighting that took place over the course of 1 month. Today, completely rebuilt, it stands as a monument of the futility of war. Every citizen there knows the meaning of never again.
The American flag is a symbol of hope and inspiration. Three of our 106th Division veterans who spent several months in German captivity will now recite the Prisoner of War Pledge of Allegiance, a powerful message about the meaning of serving their country and the flag. I request your attention for John Glenn Bevel, K Company, 424th Infantry, Bob Pope, Battery A, 590th Field Artillery, and Herb Shaner, Company G, 422nd Infantry. Their presentation will be followed by a rendition of the hymn, America the Beautiful, by Lily Rose Seacrest, great-granddaughter of Robert M. Wood, Company I, 423rd Infantry, and his widow, Wilma. She is granddaughter to myself and my wife, Patricia Wood. We are proud of her participation in this presentation, honoring her great-grandfather's service and that of his brothers in arms. By all means, feel free to join in the singing.
POW Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag.
I am an American. I was a POW.
I have served my country. I need no one to tell me what allegiance I owe to my flag, to my home.
This is my country. I have fought for it.
I have been imprisoned for it. I have died for it.
This flag stands for me, for love. My love for my family, my love for my friends.
I did not forsake it when I was beaten, when I was starved, when I was killed.
I am one man. I have one country. I worship one God.
Under God, I was saved. Under God, I have no fear.
My allegiance is to liberty, to justice. My flag represents the best of myself.
My effort, my home, my country.
I will pledge allegiance to the flag.
I will pledge under the love of God.
It is my right,
my privilege, my duty. I have earned it.
Tell me not how. I have given you much.
I am an ex-POW.
Take nothing more from me.
I pledge allegiance to the flag
of the United States of America
and to the Republic for which it stands.
One nation under God, indivisible,
with liberty and justice for all.
I pledge allegiance to the flag.
Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of grain, for purple mountain majesties above the fruited. raging strife, who more than self their country loved, and mercy more than life. America, America, may God thy gold refine, till all success be nobleness, and every that sees beyond the years, thine alabaster cities gleam, undimmed by human tears. America, America, God shed his grace on thee,
coming along guys in the real small group so we didn't get hit by artillery. And he said, we've been cut off and surrounded.
Tried to report it back through my radio to the 423rd headquarters. So all I said was, you know, they demanded our surrender and we refused.
So my job was to get down there and give that message to them, which I did. And so then they said, go back and tell them that we're on our way.
And what had happened, the Germans withdrew that night.
It took me 3 days to get through. I finally got to the edge of west of St. Vith, Belgium, and the 7th Armored was there trying to help defend them. And there I got captured next day with the 7th Armored.
We left from a rendezvous area near dawn, and it wasn't long before the German tanks counterattacked. There was no end to the wounded coming in.
During the night, a German mortar or something hit our half track, which was full of ammo. And so we got a wonderful 4th of July display in the middle of the night. But when the Germans attacked the third time, well, I guess it was about 10 o'clock in the morning, this time they attacked us with two reinforced infantry companies, which is about 600 men, and they just rolled over us.
And anyway, the captain and the other officers in the lead jeep, when they got down to the T in the roadway, the Germans were sitting there with their big bazooka. That took care of the officers.
I got the order to abandon the gun and try to get back to the armored cars, and we'd see if we could fight our way out. As soon as I got out in the open, a burp gunner jumped up and had me in his sights, and he fired burst after burst after me. I could hear the bullets whistling around. Nothing touched me. Made it to an armored car, landed in the gunner's seat. So I yelled at the driver there, how do I fire this damn thing? He yelled back, so I put in a shell, closed the breech, we started off. But we didn't get very far. The road was blocked, and cherries just swarmed all over us like ants.
They were catching it really bad down there. And as I remember, there was a colonel who was out there, and he waved a white flag and gave orders for us to surrender.
And as we were out in the open and then, finally, we got the order to lay down our weapons.
Sometime in the afternoon, they rounded us up, marched us back to Prüm, spent the night there in a church. They marched to Gerolstein and marched us by a lineup of tanks that were going to attack our positions had we not caved in that day. That would have been disaster. None of us would have survived a tank attack.
at that time, our 422nd and our 423rd were getting captured. And we stayed there for a day and a half, or 2 days and a half, till everything got cut off at the rear echelon. We couldn't stay no longer, so we had to get out. I think it was on the 19th at 11 o'clock at night. Orders come down to take everything you had and destroy everything that you can't carry. And we was on our own. So you're on your own to find your way back.
Powerful and gripping memories that need to be remembered. Our association chaplain, Pastor Chris Edmonds, will now lead us in prayer with the invocation at the East Tennessee State Veterans Cemetery in Knoxville, Tennessee. The invocation is followed by the Act of Remembrance presented by our Association Membership Committee Chair, Jackie Coy.
Welcome. I'm at the Tennessee Veterans Cemetery in Knoxville, Tennessee. Many veterans are buried here. They've given their all. They've left us a legacy of freedom. May we always remember them. Join me in prayer. Almighty God, we praise you for blessing our nation with freedom, freedom secured by noble soldiers who sacrificed so much. Thank you especially for the brave men of the 106th Infantry. We take comfort in remembering their valiant service during World War II. We remember their fighting spirit to never give up. We remember precious loved ones who died in battle. All are more than heroes. We remember loved ones wounded and captured. We rejoice in all warriors of the 106th, whose lives were forever changed in battle. Noble men who forever changed our lives with the gift of freedom. We praise you, Lord, for raising up so great a generation. Their legacies of freedom, justice, and peace have blessed us and our world immeasurably. May we honor them best by following their footsteps of duty, honor, service, and love of country. Bless our beloved Golden Lions and their families with love, joy, and peace. We pray in your matchless name that is above every name. Amen.
I will be reading the names of those veterans of the 106th Association whose loved ones have advised us that they passed away in the last year. John Crane Andrews, 592 Field Artillery Battalion, Battery A. Clifford D. Armgard, 422H. Dominic T. Bocchino, 422K. Edward Lewis Bode, 422L Company. Victor W. Bright, 422I. Fred F. Chermack, Senior, 423H and 424D. Frank W. Cherumble, 423D. Virgil L. Collins, 423 Headquarters. James Lefebvre Edwards, 423 K Company. Leon Goldberg, 422D. Sylvester Golombuski, 423 Medic. Joseph C. Haynes, Sr., 106th Recon. Michael H. Honkus, Sr., 422L. Franklin R. Kohler, 424D. Richard T. Dick Lockhart, 423 Anti-Tank. Howard Lowenberg, 423E. Kenneth C. McCluskey, 106th. R. H. Pearson, Jr., 422I. Charles O. Purrington, 422H. Anthony Rand, 589 Field Artillery Battalion, Battery B. Jimmy G. Russell, 422C. John R. Schaffner, 589 Field Artillery Battalion, Battery A. Joseph G. Scotty, 423B. John Thomas Stewart, 423rd. Chester C. Wenk, 424B. Jack P. Williams, 424B. Donald Jordan Young, 422I. And Lawrence Larry Zito, 106th. And may they rest in peace.
From across the Atlantic, now I introduce our Association Belgian liaison, Carl Wouters, and his wife, Sophie, who have placed the memorial wreath at the POW monument that was inaugurated last year in the Belgian village of Schoenberg.
In December 1944, this village was the spot where approximately 7,000 men of the 106th Infantry Division were forced to surrender after having spent 4 days behind enemy lines. They had suffered many casualties and were without food, water, ammunition, and medical supplies. This beautiful new monument stands as a tribute to the sacrifice of the 106th and by extension honors the service of all prisoners of war, regardless of nation. I encourage everyone to visit it in person and reflect on the history it represents.
May this monument serve as a beacon of remembrance to the forgotten men of World War II, the prisoners of war. As the great-grandson of a World War I veteran, who was also a World War II POW, I feel a deep connection to the men of the 106th. They faced two enemies, bullets, incoming mortars and artillery on the front lines, and starvation and illness in the camps. Even though it's been 76 years, our country has not forgotten. We owe our liberators a debt of gratitude that can never be repaid.
Went to Lindbergh, saw like 12A. We were there on the night of the 23rd when the British bombed the rail yards.
And they hit the prison camp on the night of the 23rd of December. Killed most of the officers. All of my craft killed in that bombing. When I came to, I was out in the yard.
We just hung the wall so that the hunks of plaster wouldn't fall on us. Next day was Christmas Eve. We had a celebration as best we could. The Germans were really quite generous, gave us barley soup and bread and stuff like that. Joined in the singing. First and only time that we experienced that kind of generosity. On Christmas Eve, we were all together.
By Christmas Eve, well, we got in the town of Geraldstein. That's where we were headed for, to get on boxcars. We got on the boxcars as ordered, because that would take us back to the prison. We were locked in. I'll tell you, so many people in the boxcars, you were just all standing up and couldn't even, no place to sit down. And I don't know how they got crammed in there. Our first sergeant was second person from me. But it wasn't long after we got in the boxcar that I could hear the 50 caliber machine gun bullets splintering that went along firing at the interior of these boxcars. And it went over twice. And by that time, this man 2 feet from me, he got bullets through the chest. After the second round, one boy got out through an air vent and ran along and opened up all the boxcars. And we formed a big PW in the snow immediately. And then that airplane came over, wagged its wings, went on. The damage had been done. Apparently our officers, and I guess all the men, felt exactly the same way. We don't want in those boxcars. We were going to walk back to the riot, which was a considerable distance.
The guys who had marched in shoe packs, which are rubberized boots, I thought were very lucky until they got to Karlstein. There the Germans took all of them away and gave them to their own troops and gave those guys nothing. So they had to march in their bare feet.
I remember one time when we went through Koblenz, somebody threw some apples out of the top story of a building. down into the column. Of course, there were hundreds of guys, but two or three officers. Somebody got lucky, you know. And they just bombed every building around us. They got me to, they call it a hospital. It was close to Holly. And there was the first time we got any American Red Cross packages. Of course, the cigarettes and the chocolate was all gone. But that more or less, I think, saved my life.
We got half a Red Cross package and five men to it. You got to divide that up equally, you know. That takes some real intense discussion, you know. How many cigarettes is a can of salmon worth? Food was all you ever thought about.
And they took us to Leipzig. And we had to work repairing the railroads that had been bombed out. So that went on. And then the night of the 21st of February, there was no bombings. And so there were no railroads to be fixed. So they took us to the center of Leipzig, and we didn't work repairing trolley tracks. Now, Leipzig had not been touched in the war. On the 22nd, about noontime, a wave of B-17s came over, and another wave, and another wave, for 3 hours. And they leveled Leipzig. When our day was over, around 5 o'clock, we had to walk out. And the people mocked us and threw stuff at us because they, although they knew we didn't do it, they knew Americans did it, and we were Americans. So they cussed at us and threw things and so on.
We arrived at this place called Bad Orb. I knew it was a bad place because it said so, but I didn't know where it was. But there were a few men who died every day or so. Some of them because they gave up, I think. Just crawled into a shell and gave up on trying to figure out how to make things better, extend your life. But I was not of that character, so to speak. So I always knew I was going to live.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, it is time for the memorial message prepared by our association chaplain, Pastor Chris Edmonds.
Chris's father was Master Sergeant Roderick Roddy Edmonds of Headquarters Company 422nd Infantry Regiment. Along with the men of his company, he was captured and sent to Stalag 9B at Bad Orb and later 9A at Zingenheim, Germany. For his refusal to comply with a German order to force the segregation and deportation of captured Jewish American servicemen at Stalag 9A, Master Sergeant Edmonds, a Christian, was posthumously awarded the title of Righteous Among the Nations. This is the highest award the State of Israel can bestow on non-Jews who risked their lives to save Jews during the Holocaust. Edmonds was the only one of five Americans to receive this award who actively served during World War II.
Soldiers slumbered as the final strains of taps echoed through the camp. Day is done, gone the sun, from the lake, from the hill, from the sky. All is well, safely rest. God is nigh. At Reveille, they were shipping out. The safe quarters of Camp Atterbury would be a distant memory. Some were anxious. Some dreamed of home. Some slept like a baby. All prayed. The recent words of their Major General, Alan Walter Jones, commander of the 106th Infantry, reminded them what was at stake. Be proud of your assignment, of the fact that you have been selected for a combat division, that on your shoulders rests the responsibility for the victory we have to win. Never forget that your individual part is of first importance to the success of the division. On 11 October 1944, the 106 traveled by train to Boston and later to New York City. At the Hudson River piers, volunteers from the Salvation Army handed out kit bags filled with combs, toothbrushes, toothpaste, and other much appreciated goodies. Aboard the RMS Aquitania and other transports, thousands of young soldiers from the 422nd, 423rd, and 424th regiments left New York Harbor bound for the European theater and a rendezvous with Hitler. All were ready to fight, and fight they did. After a surprise attack, with little more than bullets and rifles, and a lot of guts, our brave boys stood their ground against overwhelming German forces in the largest and bloodiest battle of World War II. The Nazis had expected to glide through the Ardennes to victory, but lions stood in their way. According to Major General Jones, during the first 48 hours, the 106th Infantry Division, alone and unaided, solely by its refusal to give ground and open the way to the West, decided the fate of Hitler's last bid for Europe. German General Manteuffel confirmed the 106th heroic stand by saying a whole army corps was delayed by your defense around St. Vith. These troops in this area held up the German corps 5 days longer than our timetable allowed, and so they forced to detour the attacking forces so much the more as my right neighbor, the 6th SS Panzer Army, had no success. In your imagination, come with me to the icy foxholes of the Ardennes. The day is 16 December 1944. The hour is 05:30. The place is the Chênaie Eiffel on the Belgium-German border. The Battle of the Bulge begins. Feel the frozen earth erupt. Pine trees explode into deadly wooden spikes as hell appears like a ghost in the forest. Watch the frigid air turn fiery red. Hear the roar of cannons, the rat-a-tat-tat of machine guns, the churning of panzers, the snap and crackle of rifle fire. Smell the smoke, feel the cold, hear the screams, the prayers, the curses, and the choked cries of the wounded and dying. Feel the fury as enemy artillery erupts around Corporal John Schaffner, and concussions fling him to the ground as he tries to crawl into his helmet. Look through the eyes of Sergeant John Klein of the 423rd M Company, to see a pistol belt and canteen dangling in a splintered tree from a fellow GI who wandered into a minefield. Stand motionless behind Private First Class Harry Martin of the 424th L Company as you hear the sinister screech of screaming meanies and death chills run up and down his spine. Dive headlong into a frozen ditch with Private First Class Bob Pope, 590th Artillery Battalion, as a German ME-109 appears out of the fog strafing him, killing several of his buddies. Crawl through the snow with Sergeant Russell Lang, 423rd I Company, as he directs mortar fire on an enemy sniper while bullets whiz over his head. Then crawl back only to see your buddy from Texas lying in the snow, lifeless from the dead sniper's bullet. Out of ammo, stand up and run toward the battle with Staff Sergeant Jack Smith, Company B, 423rd, as he and three buddies charge Germans with fixed bayonets while dodging deadly artillery and shrapnel. Taste the fear of death alongside Corporal Murray Stein, Company I, 423rd, as his friends are killed while his company and regiment are wiped out during four horrific days of battle. Sense the danger of Private First Class Leon Goldberg, 422nd, Company D, as he stares at his dog tags with the letter H, knowing he's being captured by Jew-hating Nazis. Feel the numbing cold and deep hunger with Private First Class Herb Shaner, 422nd, Company G, as he destroys his beloved rifle and reluctantly surrenders with 500 of the remaining men of the 422nd and 423rd. March in step with Sergeant Robert Wood, Company I, 423rd, as he trudges past dead American boys, their bodies frozen stiff with their stocking feet sticking up where Jerry had taken off their boots and shoes. Stand with Yiddish-speaking Tech Sergeant Hank Friedman, 422nd Headquarters Company, as he hears a German sergeant shouting, "We can't waste time with these vermin. Shoot them and let's go." Fall out at Stalag 9A with Staff Sergeant Lester Tannenbaum, 422nd Headquarters Company, and 1,200 defiant POWs, as my father, Master Sergeant Roddy Edmonds of the 422nd, courageously stands with a Luger pressed to his head and proclaims, "We are all Jews here." Now walk with me down the rows of simple white crosses and stars of David that mark the silent graves at the Henri Chaffel American Cemetery in Belgium. Gaze up at the bronze statue of the Angel of Peace, standing above the graves, bestowing the olive branch upon the heroic dead for whom he makes special commendation to the Almighty. The graves of our brave boys are the permanent and visible symbols of their heroic devotion and sacrifice to our great country and the world in the common cause of humanity. Today and every day, we must remember that the courageous resistance of our beloved golden lions in the frigid, frightening forest of the Ardennes came with great cost. Thousands of our men were captured, enduring untold hardships that hounded them the rest of their lives. Hundreds more gave their all. 700 men of the 106th Division died. Another 73 men died while in service with attached units. 215 men died as prisoners of war. 444 men were killed in action. 79 men died of wounds from battle, and 54 men are listed as missing in action. The names of these brave heroes who sacrificed their lives are recorded at 106infantry.webs.com. I encourage you to visit the site and reflect on every name. You will be filled with gratitude, you will be blessed, and most important, you will remember them. The Bible clearly says in Psalm 112, verse 6, "The man who is right and good will be remembered forever." 75 years later, we pause to remember and honor the righteous men of the 106th, both the living and the dead. Our gratitude is boundless. Our debt is eternal. Our reverence is holy. Their gallantry and sacrifice is unmistakable. This passing generation of ordinary men who did extraordinary things deserves our gratitude and respect. They won history's worst war and saved the world. They built the America you and I know and love. We benefit from their service and sacrifice every day. They truly are the greatest generation. Not a day goes by that I don't pause and thank God for them. I hope you do too. The best way we can honor them is to remember them and rejoice in the precious freedoms they secured. We are free because they loved God, loved their country, and loved us enough to die for us. Recently, I stood in the brilliant sun of a summer afternoon and heard the crack of rifles, watched old soldiers fold the flag, and whisper grateful words to a grieving family. Another warrior was laid to rest. As I heard the plaintive melody of taps, I wondered, who will take their place? Who will remember? Who will tell their stories? Who will celebrate their lives? Who will defend freedom as they did? I will. You will. We pray our children and grandchildren will. Our greatest honor is to remember them and walk in their hallowed footsteps. Then we too can join the refrain as we walk the sacred path of freedom they helped blaze.
Day is done, gone the sun, from the lake, from the hill, from the sky. All is well, safely rest. God is nigh.
God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with light from above. From the mountains to the prairies to the oceans, wide we fall.
Our association immediate past president and webmaster, Wayne Dunn, shall now present a powerful prayer dedicated to the millions of servicemen and women who faithfully continue to keep their country and the world safe. Wayne's father, Captain Thomas Dunn, commanded the 3rd Battalion Headquarters Company of the 424th Infantry Regiment during the Battle of the Bulge and beyond.
A prayer for those in places of conflict today. Young warriors, should you find yourself on the battlefield, may your cause be a just one. May your courage not falter. May you show mercy to your enemies. May your efforts bring the blessing of peace. May you be triumphant and earn victory. May your sacrifices be always appreciated. May you endure the conflict unharmed. Should you be harmed, may your wounds heal. Should you perish in the struggle, may God embrace you and find a place for you in his kingdom. Amen.
It was tough going during the night because we were just three or four in a group. Yeah, it was still foggy, you know.
Yeah, I guess it was the 21st, the morning of the 21st, we came out to the 82nd, and they took us back to Vilsom.
During the night, we finally made our way back through St. Vincent in the rear echelon. We tied up with the 7th Armored back there.
And the Jeep pulled in, and it was General Gavin. They have the 82nd Airborne. He looked at me and he says, "Where's your helmet, soldier?" When I explained, I tried to explain that I had lost it coming out, he looked disgusted. He said to somebody, "Get these men out of here."
We jumped around a lot. Kind of fought like a rifleman. Christmas Day, we took off and captured Van Hay. And I think that, they say, that was kind of a stepping stone to get Hitler on the run.
The Germans had been stopped, and in January we started on the offensive.
And that's when we started fighting as a combat team. After Christmas and New Year's, after that, they were pretty well on the run, you know, and we wouldn't, so they weren't giving too much resistance anymore.
And January 25th was, some consider that the last day of the Battle of the Bulge, and that's the day I was hit by a shrapnel, you know, in about 10 different places, laid in the snow for about 7 hours. This one morning, and I couldn't believe it, I was in a bed with sheets, and it was warm, there was music playing. The first song I heard was, "What a Difference a Day Makes."
What a difference a day makes. 24 little hours brought the sun and the flowers where there used to be rain. My yesterday was blue, dear. Today I'm part of you, dear. My lonely nights are through, dear. Since you said you were mine, what a difference a day made. And the difference is you.
Just before the war ended, they didn't know what to do with the remainder of the 106th. So they sent us down to the Brittany Peninsula. There was a pocket of Germans down the Sentinel's there who had never surrendered. Finally, in about 3 or 4 days, they came out of there and surrendered. We spent the rest of the year up in Germany, up and down the Rhine River. Finally got past Paris in August. We got in there, that was real nice.
For the recess of colors, we again go to the Luxembourg American Military Cemetery, where the U.S. Honor Guard retires the Stars and Stripes past the grave of General George S. Patton, Jr. Hereafter, Pastor Chris Edmonds will offer his benediction.
I'm at the grave of my mother, Mary Ann Edmonds, and my father, Master Sergeant Roddy Edmonds of the 106th Infantry, 422nd Regiment. To my father and all the men of the 106th, we are grateful. God bless you for serving. Please join me in prayer. Gracious God, thank you for the men of the 106th, those who are living with you today in heaven, and those who are still on this earth. May your blessings abound to them and their families. May you watch over them and love them and care for them. Thank you for each and every one, for the freedoms that they've given us. May we honor them by living free and defending freedom. Till next year, Lord, I pray that you will keep them, that you will bless them, that your face will shine upon them, that you will be gracious to them, that your countenance will be upon them, and that you will give them peace. We pray in your matchless name. Amen.
Colonel Waters was General Patton's son-in-law. But we've ended up in the same prison camp in 13C, and he was in the officers' barracks, and Patton made a big mistake. He sent a brigade up to try to rescue his son-in-law. And that brigade was set up at the end of March.
It was a very quiet afternoon when all of a sudden we start in the distance, we could hear artillery fire. I don't know just how many hours later the tanks came through the enclosure of the camp. I understood there were many in there. They said they could only take a few, but I thought if we made it, I would be in time for our first anniversary with Aki.
The brigade was practically wiped out. Waters was shot and wounded. He never got out of there.
And as soon as the German tanks counterattacked, we jumped off the tanks and ran into the forest.
My buddy, Bill Holland, got out. They finally worked their way back to the American lines, but by that time we were liberated. We were liberated April 6th.
And captured a couple of days later, and we marched out of the area. First leg was to Nuremberg, and then eventually to Moosburg.
On the 10th of April, we were camped along a dirt road in the thick woods, and on the other side of the road was open meadow, not a tree or a bush to be seen. You could see the American front. It was not more than a day or two in front of us. Fires, and you could hear explosions. We took the opportunity, and figuring that the guards would be watching for people trying to escape back in the woods, wouldn't expect anybody to try to go across the open country. So that's what we did, and then started looking for American troops. You know, they were coming up fast. We encountered a jeep full of troops from the 7th Armored. Carlton and I were scared stiff that these Americans would shoot first and then asked who we were. I had a German field jacket on. I still had that Serbian cap. Carl had a French overcoat. You know, we didn't know what they'd mistake us for. But they looked at us and laughed and said, "My God, you guys are the sorriest looking troops I've ever seen."
Pat came into Moosburg, and then we were put on trains. And when we arrived in Rheims at 2 in the morning, I think it was the 7th of May, they were signing the treaty. All the lights were on, so it was quite a spectacular event.
A couple days later, a number of Zeke 47 came in and landed and took us to Camp Lucky Strike. They nourished us, and then we back home.
And by the time I was down to 112 pounds from about 165 at the chow line, because we got steaks, you know. That was heaven, you know.
Lucky Strike, I was sent back to the States, and I was back home on the 15th of May, which is one day before my 20th birthday.
And when I got back home, and a lot of people said, "Well, you must have been a hero of being captured and everything." I don't consider myself a hero. I consider myself a survivor.
For some reason, I've been thinking more than usual about it this year, because it's 75 years, and I never thought I'd be here this long.
We were very lucky. I was very lucky, and so was my buddies. Yeah, there's still memories there. It's been a long time, but there's still memories.
Ladies and gentlemen, I am proud to have been able to share with you the fruits of the ideas and the efforts of the Board of Directors of the 106th Infantry Division Association. We are so fortunate to have the men and women with the skills and the imagination to produce such a reverence of our veterans of the 106th Infantry Division. All members contributed to the final product. A special thanks to you goes out to several of our veterans who participated in this presentation. Bob Pope, our association president, John Bevel, Herb Shaner, Paul Thompson, Harry Martin, Lawrence Clements, Richard Lewis, Dr. James Yamasaki, and several others. And to our chaplain, Pastor Chris Edmonds, for such a reverent reminder of the Battle of the Bulge. Jackie Coy for presenting the Act of Remembrance. Miss Lily Rose for sharing her singing talent. Wayne Dunn for his presentation of the Young Warrior's Prayer, as well as Lisa Dunn. And a special thank you to Carl Wolters from Belgium and his wife Sophie for allowing him the time to get this done. Carl is the genius behind the project. He was able to take original Signal Corps footage as well as views from the actual battlefield and blend them together in such a memorable way to produce a memorial service you witnessed today. I encourage you to share the link to this video with your friends and family and keep an eye on our website for information on our next reunion. It's planned for September 2021. We hope to see you there. Thanks, stay safe, and God bless.